The Apostle Paul wrote, "Christ Jesus has destroyed death and has brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. Jesus Christus hat dem Tode die Macht genommen und das Leben und ein unvergängliches Wesen ans Licht gebracht durch das Evangelium." In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We are gathered here today to mourn the death of Eckard Georg Engelbrecht. We are sad at his death. We mourn his loss. And yet at the same time, we are also so thankful for a long life, well lived, and for everything that he meant to us. And today we want to thank God for that too. Today we place ourselves under God's word, and God's word reminds us that God is our hope and comfort, always, even in the face of death. In him we live, in him we can die, and because of him we will rise again according to his will. Als Christen glauben wir, dass der Tod nicht das Ende ist. Wir erwarten das ewige Leben. Gott hat es in und durch Jesus Christus versprochen. In diesem Glauben suchen wir heute Trost aus Gottes Wort. The hymns that we are going to sing today were Uncle Eckhart's favorites. German hymns that meant a lot to him, that he read and sang again and again. In the hymn sheets, all the hymns are printed both in German and in English. The words in both languages fit the music, and you are welcome to choose the language in which you would prefer to sing. The first hymn that we are going to sing today is the hymn Jesu geh voran. It asks Jesus to lead the way through everything that comes our way in life, through every situation we face, in joy and in grief. Wir singen nun den ersten Gesang, Jesu geh voran.
Wir wollen nicht verweilen.
Uncle Eckard had two favorite psalms, ones that he read and prayed again and again. We heard a well-known hymn of the one, Psalm 23, as the prelude earlier, and both psalms will feature in this service. Let us take some time now to pray with the words of that Psalm 23, "The Lord is my shepherd." Lasst uns beten. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. Der Herr ist mein Hirte, mir wird nichts mangeln. Weidet mich auf einer grünen Aue und führet mich zum frischen Wasser. Erquicket meine Seele. Führet mich auf rechter Straße um seines Namens willen. Und ob ich schon wanderte im finstern Tal, fürchte ich kein Unglück, denn du bist bei mir. Dein Stecken und Stab trösten mich. Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I shall fear no evil, for you are with me. You are with me, and your rod and staff, they comfort me. Surely goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Lord, we are here today to say farewell to Eckard Engelbrecht. He was a father, a grandfather, and great-grandfather. He was a family member and a friend to us. You know each and every one of us. You know the things we carry. You know our grief. In our grief, we turn our eyes to you, our rock and our salvation, our helper and comforter. Wir wissen, dass bei dir die Worte des Lebens zu finden sind. Du bist der Herr über Leben und Tod. Deswegen kommen wir zu dir und bitten, dass du diese Worte des Lebens, Worte des Trostes, in unsere Herzen sprichst. Herr, erbarme dich. Christe, erbarme dich. Herr, erbarme dich unser. Amen. I'd like to ask Nolene to come forward and to say a few words.
Papa was born on the 17th of December, 1929, in Seven Oaks, which is quite close by. He was actually born. I had, before that, I thought, well, he was a Northern Natala and that's where he lived. But you will see his story went all over. They moved many, many times, as Imhold will attest to. They were in many different places. So after he was born, soon after, they moved to Harding, and his father was in the tree felling business. And then at around 4 years of age, they then moved to Louisburg in Zululand. And there they lived on two different farms. And when he was in the school-going age, he was actually home educated at that stage with tutors because there were no schools nearby. So he was there until at about age 8, 9, they moved to Mkuzi. And then he was registered at Hermansburg School, and he went to Hermansburg School for 6 years, from 1938 to 1944. Now, that whole time before he went to Hermansburg School, he had incredible stories to tell. Papa was a real storyteller, as our children can attest to, and when we went to bed, we heard the stories of the Vuzamanzis and who knows what his adventurous life as a young boy out in Zululand, telling us that he could shoot an antelope with a 303, whatever that means, I still don't understand it, at around age eight or nine. So him and his two brothers, they were riding donkeys and just had an incredible farm family life in Zululand. And then he went to school in Hermansburg, and he could only go home twice a year in the long holidays, winter and summer. And he had to go back by train, that long trip from Hermansburg all the way back home, because of the Second World War. There was not enough petrol for cars, so they had to go back by train. He always said to me he did not enjoy school. He did not like sitting behind a desk. He'd rather be out in the outdoors, yet he loved reading, and that's where I get that from. just loved reading, and he always encouraged us to stay up to date with current events. Always had the newspaper and books that he was reading, and obviously the Bible. He had a very close relationship with our Heavenly Father. Anyway, then while he was in Hermannsburg, his father then bought a farm in Vryheid, and that's where the Vryheid story then started. And the family moved to their new home, and that's when Papa went to high school in Vryheid. And he finished his Standard 10 in 1948. At that stage, his father sold the farm and bought a garage, so Papa became a mechanic. He learned mechanical skills in the garage. And then when he was about 21 years old, his father sold the garage and they moved down to Ikopo. And they did tree felling, and Opa and Uncle Johannes and my Papa were in that business together. And then soon after that, after they moved to Ikopo, his father bought a farm at Mkuzi, and they decided that Papa must go up to Mkuzi and manage that farm. So he was back in Zululand again. And he tried sisal farming, but he said that didn't work out. And then they decided to do cattle ranching. And he tells one story of having to go to Vryheid and buy cattle. And then he herded them down physically for 2 days back home. And all, of course, the adventures that went along with that. So it was, he could tell just the most incredible stories. And then his parents then moved back from Ikopo to Vryheid, and Uncle Johannes continued with the tree felling business in Ikopo. And then when Opa was about 26 years old, my Papa, then his father exchanged the Mkuzi farm for a Vryheid farm, and then Papa came to Vryheid and managed that farm. So he was very much, what his dad did, he put his hand into that business, whatever his dad was doing. And he helped with mechanics or tree felling or cattle farming or whatever farming his father was doing. And during that time when he was now on the farm in Vryheid, his parents still moved 3 times within Vryheid. So he says, wie is in viel rum gezogen. Anyway, so that was his early life. And then in 1958, when he was about 28, 29 years old, he met this lovely young lady who was 9 years his junior, Tante Renata's sister, Ortrud Lydia Holtz, at a wedding in Vryheid. Hildegard Fortmann and Günther Gevers, I don't know if you know them, at that wedding. That's where they met. And then there were regular visits from Vryheid to Schroeder's, because Ortrud lived down here in Schroeder's. And then on one of the trips back home, late in the evening, Papa was actually hit by a train at the Dundee crossing, but he survived it with just really minor injuries. So that was another adventure he could tell us about. And then in 1959, about a year later, he moved to Pinetown so that he was closer to his sweetheart. And he worked for Wheeler's Transport. So then he went into the transporting business. So he did many different things. And then in 1960, on the 30th of January, Papa was 30 and Mama was 21, and he married his angel. Those two. They had the most unique relationship, Papa and Mama. But he loved her with such an incredible love. And she was always his angel. And all I can say is they were unique. But they were married for 58 years, and they were an incredible example of commitment and dedication to one another through difficult years, and they had their difficult years. After they got married, they lived in Pinetown for 2 years, and that's where I was born. And Papa then stopped the Wheelers transport business. He said it was just too much, always the licensing and hours on the road and being away from home. He just felt that was not the right thing as a young father and husband. So he decided to stop that, and they moved down to Ikopo, back to your father, Liesl, to be in business again, in the tree felling business, and they lived there in a little cottage. And then soon after that, that's when Opa Holtz got sick, and they asked Papa and Mama to come up to Schroeder's to help on the farm. And that's when my dad then moved to Schroeder's to help with the farming. Opa Holtz on the farm there, and Opa Holtz's grave is right there. It's just quite a lot of family history around here. And then that's where Cheryl was born in 1963. And Opa was then in his 30s. And I was thinking to myself, that's the age that Kevin and Marcel are in now. Brendan, your age. And those years were hard for Opa. Very, very hard. Because Oma got so ill. Anyway, so then Dalton Discount House expanded, and Papa built a bigger building, which is still standing in Dalton near Frenzel's garage. So all very closely connected, that whole season of our lives. Then in 1992, at age 71, Papa and Mama moved to Pietermaritzburg in Morgan Road, and Papa started a new business, Maggie's secondhand clothing shop. And then in 1994, Oma Holtz passed away, and that's when Papa and Mama bought 3 Dickinson Mews. He lived in July, he was moved to frail care as his body was getting really weak. And then one month later, on the 12th of August, at age 91, after a short illness, which started the day before, he passed away into eternity to meet his precious Savior.
Yeah, I think a lot has been said, but I think the incredible thing, Mom mentioned it, Marcel mentioned it, Kevin mentioned it, and I'm going to sort of repeat a lot of what has been said, but I think the incredible thing is that one person had an impact on a lot of people's lives and had an impact in a way that everyone could relate to. And I think that was incredible about Orpah. Orpah was an example of a godly man. A godly man and an incredible gentleman. I think if I ever met a true gentleman, it was Orpah. The way in which he treated Oma, he treated her as he called her, his angel. The way he treated people, he respected every person as a person. He respected each person as an individual who deserved utmost respect. He was selfless in everything that he did. He never needed anything back. He gave of himself, and he was quite happy with that. I think, as Kevin and myself said, just having had Opa and Oma up the road as young children, as young boys, was an incredible thing. The times that we would spend with them, they would come down almost every day to our home. Then we would sometimes go and run up the road to their place and have first supper with Opa and Oma at 4:30 in the afternoon, and then come home, run home, and have second supper at home at about 6:30 or so. And just the times that we could spend with them, for me, it's such a privilege that I got to have an Opa until I was 27. I think a lot of people, when I speak about how much do you know your grandparents, oh, they passed away when I was 4 or something. But having had an Opa until the age that I'm now has been an incredible thing to have that relationship with him. Opa always told us bedtime stories when we went and visited and slept over. He basically had 2 stories. And those 2 stories all had variations to them. The one story was about Bambi winning the race. He always somehow won the race at the end, and the other one was about Orpah's favorite pirates. Orpah was a man of few words. He really lived out the Reden ist Silber, Schweigen ist Gold. But when he spoke, when Orpah spoke, I listened, because I knew that he's going to speak wisdom. He had an incredible relationship with God, a very pure relationship with God. Often, as Mom's already mentioned, but on the farm, he would sit on his own on the veranda, and he would just say, "I'm not alone. God is with me." And he just had such a close and personal relationship with God, which is such a wonderful example for us as his grandchildren. Orpah taught me how to be a gentleman, not in speaking again, but just the way in which he lived. He taught me how to treat other people, every single person, with respect. He taught me that your word is your honor, and no matter what happens, if you have given your word, you stick to your word. Orpah has left me an incredible godly legacy, and I wish to follow that legacy. Orpah and Oma have been hugely instrumental in my life, and I am so, so grateful for having had the most committed grandparents that I think anyone could ever have. And I'm so, so grateful for that. Thank you.
In our church, we have a valuable tradition, something that we call the Christian duty when we take leave of a loved one. This morning, you've heard a lot about Eckard and his life and who he was and the legacy that he left for those who stay behind. And hearing that, we recognize that there's so much good that was put into our lives through him. And it's something to be thankful for and to thank God for. At the same time, we also know the truth of God's word when it teaches us that all of us are sinners who fall short of the glory of God. That was also true of him. It was also true of us. And so when we take leave of a loved one, there will always be those things we give thanks for, but also those things that we need to let go, that we need to speak forgiveness for or ask forgiveness for. We want to take some time now to bring all of that before God in a few moments of silence as I lead you through this time of reflection and prayer. Wir wollen nun auch tun, was unsere christliche Pflicht ist. Lasst uns Gott danken für alle die guten Sachen und Zeiten, die wir durch und mit Eckard erfahren durften. Let's take some time to thank God for all the good times that we shared with Eckard and the gifts that were channeled into our lives through him. Haben wir an seinem Leben etwas versäumt durch Gedanken, Worten und Werken, so wollen wir den Herrn um seine Vergebung bitten. Let us also confess the words and deeds that we said or refrained from that may have caused division or hurt to Eckard. and ask God for his forgiveness. Und hat Eckard uns einmal wehgetan, so sei ihm vergeben. Let us finally bring before God any wrongs that Eckard did or said to us and speak in our hearts the words of forgiveness. And so, having brought all of that before God, we can take leave of Eckard Engelbrecht in peace. Wir legen ihn in Gottes Hand. Möge der Herr ihm gnädig sein und ihm die ewige Erfüllung des Lebens schenken. Amen. Let us sing the next hymn. Befiehl du deine Wege, commit the ways you travel.
Dich wundern wirst.
listen to words of comfort from the Gospel of John in chapter 14. Our Lord Jesus Christ said, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God and trust in me." So spricht unser Herr Jesus Christus. Euer Herz erschrecke nicht. Glaubt an Gott und glaubt an mich. In meines Vaters Haus sind viele Wohnungen. Wenn's nicht so wäre, hätte ich dann zu euch gesagt, ich gehe hin, euch die Stätte zu bereiten. And when I go to prepare a place for you, I shall return and take you to be with me, so that you will be where I am. And where I go, you know the way. Thomas said to him, "Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way?" Jesus answered him, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one can come to the Father but through me. Ich bin der Weg und die Wahrheit und das Leben. Niemand kommt zum Vater, denn durch mich." Friede sei mit euch. Grace be with you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Let us pray. Gracious God, our Father, God of all mercies and comfort, who comforts us in times of trouble so that we can comfort others with a comfort that we ourselves have been comforted with. Comfort us through your word today. Segne du reden und hören. Amen. Dear family, dear friends, I had the privilege of getting to know Uncle Eckard very well, especially over the last few years. I often had the chance to sit alone with him, just to talk, just to listen, sometimes even just to be quiet together. And we talked about many things that were important to him. We talked about life and the joys that it brings, but also the burdens it gives you to carry. We also spoke about death, especially in the last year or so. He was a quiet man. He was humble. He was wise. We've heard some of that today. And that's how I got to know him. We will all miss him. And he quite liked his sweets. Especially a bokdrol. And I actually just want to use this to say something about the psalm that meant so much to him, Psalm 103. You see, a bokdrol has layers. And it has a center, which is pretty important. Maybe I'll take an eclair that I've brought along because it adds a layer, three layers. The outside one that protects it and does a little bit of advertising, tells the world what's inside. Then the second layer, the toffee, which is important, tastes good, but it's not at the center. Right in the center is the really important bit, the bit you want to get to, the chocolate. And pretty much like a bokdrol and an eclair, it's basically how Hebrew rhetoric works. It's not like our rhetoric or Greek rhetoric where you put the important things at the beginning or at the end. No, in Hebrew rhetoric, the important stuff is right in the middle. And Psalm 103 is like that. You can see it. So what is at the very center of this psalm that meant so much to Uncle Eckard? It has 22 verses. And it's divided into three parts, that psalm. Three layers. So one at the beginning and one at the end is one layer. Then the next layer in the middle. And then right at the center sit these words. The Lord is compassionate and gracious, slow to anger, and abounding in love. As far as the east is from the west, so far has the Lord taken our sins from us. That's the center of the psalm. Das steht im Mittelpunkt. Das will Psalm 103 uns sagen. Der Herr ist barmherzig, gnädig, geduldig, gut. That central message of Psalm 103 directs all the thoughts that you find in the layers around it. The next layer that unpacks and supports that basically says, because of this central thought, there's a lot that God does to and for us. He forgives. He heals. He redeems. He crowns. He satisfies. He pursues justice and more. And the incredible thing is, he does that for you. Dir hat deine Sünden vergeben. Deine Gebrechen heilt und erlöst dein Leben vom Verderben. Der Herr hat Gutes dir getan. And then the final layer, the layer that advertises to the world, that shows the world what's inside and who God is and what he's done. That layer that encourages us to praise him, to speak of what he has done. Praise the Lord and bless his holy name. Praise the Lord, all his works. Praise him for what he has done. Do not forget the good that he has done for you. What a beautiful psalm with such an important message, especially in Uncle Eckard's life, and especially today as we take leave of him in this way. Uncle Eckard was a blessed man, blessed with a long life, blessed with much that was good. But he certainly also experienced much that was tough, that was really difficult, much that saddened him, much that he had to bear. And he wrestled with that sometimes. There were times when he had his doubts. And I wanted to say this today. His confirmation verse, I think, is one that contributed to that. A verse that comes from Philippians 2, verse 12, and that is often misunderstood. And that in the history of our church, and especially in the generation of Uncle Eckard, was taught in that misunderstood way to create fear. And I'm not talking fear of God as in awe of God. Fear as in be careful that you are enough. Fear that makes it about us. Fear that makes us very scared of getting it wrong. And I've experienced that a lot with people at deathbeds or in the run-up to it in Uncle Eckard's generation. And there were times, probably about a year or two or three ago, when it was like that with him too, when he had this question, was I enough? Did I do enough? It was something we spoke about often when we were on our own. That is not the message. It's not the message of Psalm 103. It's not the message of Philippians 2, verse 12. Especially if we take it on its own, we're tempted into thinking that that's the message. Philippians 2, verse 12 does encourage us to live a life that lives out what we believe, that lives out a life according to the will of God. It is a verse that encourages us to have this awe of God. But if you read it in its context with everything that's around it, it becomes very clear that this awe of God is rooted in the fact that God works in us, that God works his good and loving purpose in us. Paul says it in that many words in the very next verse. That he saves us through Jesus Christ. That Jesus, who died a very low death, has the highest place, is the name above all names. That's what Paul is talking about in Philippians 2. And in fact, verse 12 starts with, therefore, because Jesus Christ has overcome and is Lord over everything, the name above all names, because of that, because he is Lord over everything, Lord over life, and even Lord over death, because of that, we can trust him. We can entrust ourselves to him and live our lives to his glory. That Lord who has done that came into this world, died on a cross so that our sin could be taken and separated from us as far as the east is from the west. That Lord is compassionate and gracious, slow to anger, and abounding in love. No wonder Psalm 103 was such a comfort to Uncle Eckard. In its central message, in the message of God's grace and love, he found peace. The last few times I visited him here at Brunfelsia, that was what struck me most. A little bit more than a year ago, very often we spoke about his struggles. In the last year or so, not once, he found peace. He found peace in this Lord, in the one whom he could know as a loving God who has him in his hands, and out of whose hand nothing can tear him. Nothing. Nothing in life. Not even death. And many of you will know this because he will have said it to you. That was the reason why he was so ready to go. Why he could say, if I die, I'm ready. And he was. And it's something we can be thankful for, something we can find comfort in, certainly something he found comfort in. But more than that, today, as you are saddened by the loss of Uncle Eckard, of Pa, of Opa, as you are saddened by this loss, may you too find peace and comfort in this message of Psalm 103. May you keep your eyes on that central message and on the God that it talks of. Vergesst ihn nicht. Vergesst nicht, was euch alles getan hat und was weiter tut. Findet Trost in ihm. Und dann tut auch, wovon Philipper 2, Vers 12 spricht. Lebt das aus. Dient ihm. Und lebt nach seinem Willen. Und der Friede Gottes, der höher ist als alle menschliche Vernunft, bewahre unsere Herzen und Sinne in Christus Jesus. Amen. Let us sing the next hymn together. It is a hymn called Harre meine Seele, Wait My Soul with Patience. A hymn that expresses the fact that God shows his goodness to us in all situations, but that also encourages us to be patient as God is patient. Wir singen zusammen Harre meine Seele.
Alles im Befehle hilft.
Let us pray. Eternal God, Lord over the living and the dead, we want to thank you today for the life of Eckard Engelbrecht, and we place him into your hands. We thank you for everything that you did for him, to him, and through him in good times and in bad. We pray for all those who grieve over him and who will miss him, those who are here today, and those who cannot be here. Comfort them through your word. Lass sie ihre Hoffnung auf dich setzen. Wir befehlen deine Gnade an, wenn du als Nächsten aus unserer Mitte abrufen wirst. Mach uns alle im Glauben bereit für unsere letzte Stunde. Stärke in uns die Zuversicht, dass du unser Leben vollenden wirst. Wir legen uns in deine Hand. And so we close our prayer, expressing our trust in you as children trust a loving Father, by speaking together the words that our Lord Jesus Christ taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. I'd like to ask Brendan to come forward with the urn. Hear the promise of our Lord Jesus Christ, who said, I am the resurrection and the life. All who believe in me will live, even though they die. At the heart of biblical blessing lies the thought that we place somebody into God's hands. And so we speak a farewell blessing over the mortal remains of our brother in Christ, and we entrust him into God's care. Eckard Georg Engelbrecht, es segne dich Gott, der Vater, der dich nach seinem Ebenbild geschaffen hat. Es segne dich Gott, der Sohn, der dich durch sein Leiden und Sterben erlöst hat. Es segne dich Gott, der Heilige Geist, der dich zu seinem Tempel bereitet und geheiligt hat. Der dreieinige Gott sei dir gnädig im Gericht und schenke dir das ewige Leben. Der Herr segne deinen Ausgang und Eingang von nun an bis in Ewigkeit. Amen. And so we place the ashes in their final resting place. Our help is in the name of the Lord who made heaven and earth. Nachdem Eckard Engelbrecht aus diesem Leben abgerufen wurde, geben wir sein Leib dahin. Erde zu Erde, Asche zu Asche, Staub zum Staube. The Apostle Paul wrote about how it will be with the resurrection of the dead. The body that is sown perishable, it will be raised imperishable. It is sown without greatness, it will be raised in glory. It is sown in weakness, it will be raised in power. Trusting this, we place Eckard Engelbrecht into God's hands. Jesus Christ will raise him on the last day. May he be gracious to him and grant him his eternal kingdom. Amen. We will now close the memorial grave while singing the next hymn. Once the grave has been closed, you are invited to place flowers on the memorial wall, to take white roses and place them in the vases provided. Wir singen nun, so nimm denn meine Hände. are here on the cemetery, if we look around us, we see many crosses. There's a reason why those crosses are a sign for us in our faith. These crosses remind us of the hope that we can hold on to, because our Lord Jesus Christ died on a cross, but also rose again to life. He defeated death. Also kann der Apostel Paulus an die Korinther schreiben, Tod, wo ist dein Sieg? Tod, wo ist dein Stachel? Gott sei Dank, der uns den Sieg gibt durch unseren Herrn Jesus Christus. Let us pray. Lord, as we take leave of Eckard Engelbrecht, we ask that you fill us with your Spirit, that you comfort us, but also that you guide us and keep us on the way forward. We pray that you keep the eternal hope alive in all of us, so that one day we too will see you in your glory. Du hast uns durch Jesus Christus errettet. Du hast den Tod besiegt und hast uns berufen in dein ewiges Reich. Erhalte uns in der Gewissheit, dass uns aus dem Tod reißt und verwandelt zum ewigen Leben. Hilf uns, dass wir deinem Sohn nachfolgen auf dem Weg, der zum Leben führt. Darum bitten wir dich durch Jesus Christus, unseren Herrn. Amen. And so, as you go from here, go in the peace of the Lord and under his blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious unto you. The Lord turn his favor towards you and give you peace. So segne und behüte euch der allmächtige und barmherzige Gott, der Vater, der Sohn und der Heilige Geist. Amen.
Beside you, all around you, and with within you, he is with you, he is with you. In the morning, in the evening, in your coming and your going, in your weeping and rejoicing, he is for you, he is for you. Ah,
I'll worship.